We've been in about six provinces now with the commander-in-chief, and in Mpumalanga as well as KwaZulu-Natal. Every meeting of the EFF, which was pre-arranged, pre-organized in terms of the bookings of public spaces that we hold, these are community meetings, have been systematically disrupted by the ANC, wearing people t-shirts, and they throw stones, they intimidate community members. And in Ngomazi, one of our members was shot and he had to be taken to hospital. In Tembisa, two of our members died because of Stuha Hostel in Tembisa by ANC members, attacked with machete and pangas by members of the ANC. In KwaZulu-Natal, again, everywhere where we went, you would find the same manner in which it's carried out in Mbombela, in Nkomazi, ANC members coming to disrupt our meetings. And the unfortunate thing is that the way in which it gets inserted into the public discourse is that we are clashing with them. Mm-hmm. But the truth is, you never see us go to anyone's meeting or organize a meeting next to anyone just to either get, you know, coverage next to them. We don't fly our flags on top of people's meetings. We don't do that. These are a clear acts of violence. It's not just them coming in and disrupting us. They beat our members up, they throw bottles and stones.
Is this orchestrated from the top? Is this a policy of, particularly you're saying ANC clad people, is this an ANC policy, or are these just people in Tembisa or in Ngomazi and so forth on their own, local activists of this party targeting you, or do you believe it's
it doesn't matter, Justice? All matters is that it must be systematic and the ANC must be silent, and it's their silence. I mean, the regional leadership in Mpumalanga, there is a regional chairperson called Ngrangwenya. He's on the record to say that they will continue to do that in Nkomazi, in Mbombela. He's on the record. Is a leader. Is a potential mayor. That's not low leadership. That's actually important in the context of local government elections. Just last week, a female member of the EFF was campaigning in Polokwane taxi rank, and a member of the ANC shot at her. Why? Because they were denying her to go and distribute pamphlets in the taxi rank. And when she refused, they entered into an argument. The guy took out a gun and shot at our member. And the ANC is dead silent. But what we are saying is very practical. The Electoral Code of Conduct provides that if you do not stick by the rules as specified in the Electoral Code, the IEC, it says one of the punishments is that you can be deregistered to participate in the elections. In those sections where the ANC is systematically, proudly planning disruptions of EFF meetings, we are calling on the IEC to ban the ANC, to deregister them from participating
but
in the
from
elections.
From what you're saying, this is not just incidents of violence here and there. You mentioned places in Mpumalanga, you mentioned KZN, and I must say I read those reports and they were quite extensive disruptions. You talk about Tembisa here in Gauteng, you talk now about Limpopo. It means that the ANC would have to be deregistered in many places.
Yeah, that's regions. It's, I mean, in Gauteng, except in Tembisa, I mean, during some of the fierce contestations on the ground, the members of the ANC here don't go for stones that easily. But I'm not talking about the entire country. We've been to the Western Cape, we've been to the Free State over the weekend. It's in selected areas, and what we're naming those areas, Mbombela, as well as in KwaZulu-Natal, in specifically in Esikaweni. We've been to anywhere else again in KwaZulu-Natal, there were no much of disruptions, but in Esikaweni and Richards Bay, members of the ANC were systematic. They were there from the morning, swearing that they are going to disrupt our meeting, and when the commander-in-chief took platform, they threw stones. Police had to disperse them with rubber bullets. And since then, I mean, that's what you have, is that there's the ANC silent, there is nobody that is imprisoned. I mean, disruption of when you disrupt a meeting, you're denying people of the freedom of assembly, which is a constitutional right. Nobody goes to prison for that.
Shouldn't so this be they a must police be deregistered.
The elect, then what is the electoral code of conduct for? Mm. The electoral code of conduct is to make sure that elections are free and fair, that I campaign without the fear of being thrown with a stone, that I campaign without the fear of being shot at.
Fair enough, but and this now has IEC, turned into hooliganism, into criminal offenses.
Yes, so that's why, I mean, that's what I'm saying. Firstly, the IEC ought to take a strong position that we're not going to let any blood drop, anybody lose their lives on the basis of campaigning.
So, Mbuyiseni, can I ask you then, the IEC then responds by saying, actually, we will bring the two parties together and mediate. They don't seem to be interested in actually going the whole hog and deregistering people.
I mean, the problem with an approach that does not punish violence is that it condones it elsewhere. People think that, you know, we will just be spoken to and sit down. I don't think we want to negotiate violence. There is a bad precedence across the country in the 1990s. There is a bad precedence in the continent. Once you allow people to kill, I'm talking about two of our members that are already dead. I'm talking about three hospital cases, even more, shot at in different places. And I'm talking about instances of systematic a disruption of our meetings, and a leader of the ANC being on the record. They are not shy. They are on the record and they are saying, look, we're going to continue to do it. So it's not like, I mean, some mediation is going to help. These people don't believe that we must campaign in those areas. They are declaring no-go areas. You must deregister the ANC in that area, teach everyone else that if you do not stick by the electoral code of conduct, we're going to punish you. You're not worthy, because you're not worthy to contest elections, because elections are about the quality of your argument, not the quality of your fists. Mm.
Will you defend yourselves against such violence?
Look, we have not been responding at all, even in Esikaweni, because the police have been able in most of the cases to protect us. They've been able to disperse those members. Even when our members was shot at, the police responded, the person was arrested. But the silence of the ANC, and when they do speak, they are proud in Ngomazi, in Graingwenya, specifically went on the record and said, we're going to continue to do that. What do you do in such an instance? They must be deregistered. They must forfeit the right to participate in the elections, because they are not prepared to do the elections in a manner that is fair, in a manner that is peaceful. Mm. Because we won't be able to go on for too long. We can't continue to tell our members, you know, hold yourselves back, do not respond. We can't continue to do that when they are being thrown stones, when they are being stabbed, when they are being shot at. We can't continue to tell them not to respond.
The Commander-in-Chief of your organization, Julius Malema, is on the record. He said this last Friday, he said this before, that in the face of violence, then the EFF will have no choice but to take up arms against the ANC.
You see, the form of violence that the CIC was talking about is state violence. That if the government continued to respond to peaceful protests, peaceful demonstrations, to the peaceful defiance of power, to the peaceful questioning of power, if it continued to do so, that its response was only violence, then we would be forced to take up arms. But we are hoping that in this case, when the hooligans, particularly the professionalized hooliganism of the ANC, is happening on the ground, that the police will continue to act. In the absence of police, if that occurs over and over again, yes, we've got the constitutional right to self-defense. We will definitely defend ourselves, be it guns, be it stones. We'll have to take up and protect our freedoms of assembly, our freedoms of choices, our freedoms of belonging to a political party of our choice, if the police don't react. But again, if the IEC, and this is the significant part, let somebody forfeit the right to stand and participate in the elections if they violate the electoral code of conduct. Otherwise, then it's just a sweetheart electoral code of conduct that can be implementable, that people won't fear, that people won't respect.
Mm. Will we have a free and fair election on August 3?
Well, if with the rate that it's going in Mbombela, there is a promise by leaders of the ANC that won't be the case. in KwaZulu-Natal, in Esikaweni. That's a promise. They tell us that we are not allowed to campaign. In Tembisa, in the hostels, they're telling us that we are not allowed to campaign. So there are spots and areas that the IEC must be proactive. It must not even be sitting in their comfortable air-conditioned offices. They should be observing the elections on the ground. They are the ones that should be telling the country that there is violence, that the ANC disrupted our meetings. They are sitting in their air-conditioned expensive offices in Centurion, as opposed to being on the ground. The elections are on the ground. That is where they are supposed to be, and only peace can be guaranteed on the ground on the 3rd of August. But justice, finally, elections don't start on the 3rd. Elections have already started. They ought to be peaceful going to the 3rd of August. If they are not peaceful going to the 3rd of August, then they could be declared as unfree and as not fair.
Mbuyiseni Ndlozi, thanks so much.
Thank you very much.
After the break, we discuss youth development with Deputy Minister in the Presidency, Buti Manamela.